Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Spain, the Trials and Triumphs of a Modern European Country by Michael Reid, narrated by Asa Siegel. Prologue, The Spanish Mirror. At its midpoint, the extended gallery that runs much of the length of the first floor of the Prado opens onto the spacious hexagonal Room 12. This spot is the fulcrum of Madrid's great art museum, left undisturbed even in the rehang of its collections during the pandemic. On the western side of the long gallery at that point hangs Titian's majestic equestrian portrait of Emperor Charles V at the Battle of Mühlberg. Some 70 paces away, the eastern wall of Room 12 is occupied by Las Meninas, Diego Velázquez's towering painting, which has come to be seen as perhaps the greatest single work in the history of European art. Ostensibly a conversation piece, a homely scene in which a sumptuously dressed princess is attended by her ladies-in-waiting, a dwarf, a dog, and palace retainers. The more the viewer looks at it, the more it resembles a riddle. For a start, the most prominent figure in the painting, the one who stares across at Charles V from afar, is the painter, Velázquez himself, portrayed standing before a large easel, working on a canvas that is hidden from us. But who is Velázquez looking at with his forensic gaze as he stands poised, brush in one hand and palette of reds and browns in the other? One answer is provided by a mirror on the back wall, which reveals the figures of the king, Philip IV, and his second queen, Mariana of Austria. It was once thought that the royal couple were merely observing the scene, that they had dropped by to greet their daughter. But the alignment of the ceiling lights show that the reflection in the mirror is not that of the monarchs themselves, but rather of the canvas that Velázquez is working on, a dual portrait of the king and queen. Velázquez was fascinated by mirrors and possessed no fewer than 12. Las Meninas is thus a painting about painting. It has multiple focal points. Velázquez's gaze is mimicked by that of the chamberlain, who stands in a lighted doorway beside the mirror. He is perhaps the most enigmatic figure in the painting. Is he entering or leaving the room? Things are much more complicated and uncertain than they might seem. Velázquez worked in the final years of Spain's golden age, when its monarchs, although embattled, still ruled much of Europe and an empire stretching from the Andes to the Philippines. Temporarily enriched by the gold and silver of the Americas, Spain enjoyed an even greater cultural wealth, exemplified by Miguel de Cervantes and his masterpiece Don Quixote, the playwrights Lope de Vega and Calderón de la Barca, Quevedo and Góngora, rival poets who detested each other, as well as Velázquez's fellow artists, such as Zurbarán, with his haunting portraits of pious monks, and Murillo, the Baroque painter of the Counter-Reformation's religious ecstasy. Yet, the glitter was misleading. Contrast Las Meninas, painted in 1656, with the Charles V portrait, painted a little over a century earlier. And it seems clear that Velázquez, the official court painter to Philip IV, is portraying decline, albeit obliquely. He had earlier painted his king in a similar equestrian pose to Titian's image of his great-grandfather, but in his greatest work, the monarchs are off stage. They are seen through a glass, darkly. They may, or may not, be standing exactly where we, the viewers, are. So, Las Meninas also seems to be a painting about us. No wonder it fascinated both Jorge Luis Borges, the Argentine writer of metaphysical stories and riddles, and Michel Foucault, the high priest of postmodernism. Las Meninas plays with our sense of certainty about what we see when we look. It asks whether we only see what we want to see. And so it is with Spain, Like Velázquez's painting, the country itself has been extensively studied and dissected. Indeed, few nations in Western Europe have been the subject of such a large literature by foreign writers, especially Britons, and one that is so cliché-ridden. Spain has served as a mirror, an often distorted one, onto which observers have projected their own visions and fantasies. Foreigners have seen, or projected, two seemingly opposed but in fact intersecting visions in the Spanish mirror. José Varela Ortega, a historian at the Complutense University in Madrid, sums these up in a 1,100-page tome published in 2019 as being the militant, passionate Spaniard, contrasted with the indolent, decadent, or degenerate Spaniard. The first view is commonly known in Spain as the Black Legend, the propaganda that newly Protestant Northern Europe deployed against the Spain of Charles V and his son, Philip II, who between them led the Catholic Counter-Reformation against what they saw as heresy. This battle began in military terms at Muhlberg in 1547, though Charles's victory there proved to be a Pyrrhic one. Spain was portrayed as cruel and obscurantist under the sway of priests and the thumbscrews of the Inquisition. As in all successful propaganda, there was truth in this, but exaggeration too. Showing prickly insecurity which may reflect the difficulty the country, indeed any country, has in coming to terms with the loss of empire, Spanish conservative thinkers have tended to present all criticism of Spain by outsiders as a product of the Black Legend. Far from fading, such commentary has gathered force in the past decade. A book defending Spain's colonial record against the Black Legend by Maria Elvira Rocabarea has become a surprise bestseller of over 100,000 copies since it was first published in 2016. For one of her critics, Rocabarea's argument is simply national Catholic populism. National Catholicism was the ideology often attributed to the dictatorship of Francisco Franco. More broadly, Spaniards are often portrayed as uniquely intransigent and violent. If one deadly sin were to define the Spanish national character, it would be pride, claims one recent account by a British author, who goes on to forecast portentously that the country is destined to follow paths involving bloodshed. If the Black Legend was originally a response to Spanish power, a second, romantic vision was evoked by Spain's subsequent decline. From the 18th century onwards, foreign observers began to view Spain as backward, a vision summed up in the sneering remark attributed to Alexandre Dumas that Africa begins at the Pyrenees. For Voltaire, who unlike Dumas never visited Spain, Spaniards were an indolent race. In the 19th century, other foreign travelers and writers began to rejoice in this supposed backwardness. They portrayed Spain as exotic, as well as decadent. Their approach was orientalist, in Edward Said's term. Spain thus became the land of the Carmen of Mérimée's novel and Bizet's opera, of lascivious women, gypsies, bandits, and song and dance. The only serious thing for Spaniards is pleasure, and they give themselves up to it with admirable abandon, commitment, and ardor, wrote Théophile Gautier, a visiting French writer. The country's alleged lack of modernity began to be seen as a sign of the authenticity of its culture. Its popular music inspired foreign composers such as Rimsky-Korsakov, Debussy, and Ravel. The English romantics, such as Richard Ford in his Handbook for Travelers in Spain of 1845, wrote of the vitality and dignity of Spaniards, a noble people who were held to be routinely betrayed by bad government and rulers. That, too, contained considerable truth. This theme was continued by two writers who indelibly fixed outsiders' view of the Spanish Civil War, Ernest Hemingway in his novel For Whom the Bell Tolls, and George Orwell in Homage to Catalonia, his memoir of fighting as a volunteer militiaman against the nationalist army of General Francisco Franco. The romantic appeal of Spain was reiterated by Franz Borkenau, an Austrian former Marxist who offered perhaps the most perceptive contemporaneous foreign account of the Civil War. He noted that almost every foreign observer, whether of the left or of the right, felt an almost magical attraction to the country. He went on, "The deep attraction of Spain consists, in my view, not so much in its political importance, but in its national character. Their life is not yet efficient. That means that it is not yet mechanized, that beauty is still more important for the Spaniard than practical use, sentiment more important than action, honor very often more important than success, love and friendship more important than one's job." One might add to this list the more basic characteristics of sun, warmth, wine, and Mediterranean food, all things which for northern Europeans contributed to the sense of contrast and otherness. The Romantics, according to Tom Burns Marañón, an Anglo-Spanish writer, created a series of stereotypes, and those clichés now form part not just of the way others see Spain, which matters little, but of the very mirror in which Spaniards look at themselves. Those clichés and stereotypes have surfaced in recent years, especially in foreign coverage of the Catalan conflict, and their internalization by Spaniards has contributed to an abiding pessimism. Like Velázquez, Spaniards have, for centuries, had an acute sense of their country's relative decline from past greatness. Sometimes exaggerated, this declinism has colored the country's political life. It still does. Travelers often become enchanted with the first country that captures their hearts and gives them license to be free, notes Wade Davis, a Canadian writer and anthropologist. In my case, that country was Spain. I first entered it on a hot Saturday afternoon in July 1971 with two university friends. We had driven from London in a battered blue Volkswagen camper van. We crossed the border at Irún and drove into San Sebastián. I have many snapshots of memory from that and later trips. The first is of the slanting evening sun in the crowded streets of the old quarter of San Sebastián as we walked from bar to bar, sampling squid and octopus, delicacies almost unknown in the still insular Britain of that time. In the residual heat, there was a pungent aroma of sewerage. Spain, then, was a far poorer country than Britain. From Madrid, we drove south through Toledo and then Puerto Llano, a stiflingly hot coal mining town of tin-roofed shacks. After marveling at the mezquita, the vast mosque in Cordoba, we stopped to buy some food at Fernán Núñez, deep in the Andalusian countryside and surrounded by olive groves. It was a whitewashed town of dirt streets and one-story houses with tiny windows, home to thousands of agricultural day laborers who spent much of the year unemployed, and prematurely aged women dressed in widow's black. One was seated in her doorway, pounding tomatoes for gazpacho in a stone pestle. Fernán Núñez stuck in my mind as the poorest place I had ever seen. We drove back almost the length of Spain's Mediterranean coast, from Algeciras to Barcelona, along the N340, a slow highway. Torremolinos and Benidorm were starting to sprout forests of high-rises, but much of the coast was still largely undeveloped. Franco was still in charge, as he had been since crushing the Republic in the Civil War. The freedom I felt was purely internal, to be outside of my own culture and in a different, more extrovert but still accessible one. I considered myself fortunate not to have to run the risks that Spaniards of my age did in opposing dictatorship. We were merely stopped sometimes and briefly questioned by stern civil guards in their tricorn hats, suspicious of three long-haired foreign young men. The next summer, I hitchhiked round a large segment of Spain, from Barcelona to Madrid and on to León, Asturias, and Galicia. In Santiago de Compostela, I fell in love with a friendly group of students from the town's big university. As term was ending, one of them invited me to stay at his family home in Vigo, Spain's largest fishing port and an important industrial city. He introduced me to the art of Spanish bar crawling on an almost non-existent budget. We would arrive in a bar just when it was serving its free pincho, a cup of shellfish soup here, a chunk of tortilla there, a plate of mussels somewhere else, all washed down with beakers of rough local wine costing one peseta. While I was in Vigo, in September 1972, the trade unions, which operated clandestinely, called a general strike. It began with a demand by workers at the big Citroën factory to limit the working week to 44 hours and went on to last a fortnight. I remember seeing groups of workers facing the police in otherwise deserted avenues. The national press, which operated under censorship, failed to mention what was the biggest news in Spain. The local paper had a small story about communist agitators. To a young and inhibited Briton, Spanish women were alluring. Arriving in a town, I would join the paseo, the early evening stroll round and round the main square that is still a mainstay of social life in provincial Spain. Groups of young women would stare and giggle, at once flirtatious and out of bounds, with a chaperone not far away and life spent under the shadow of the priest and the confessional. In the cities, I met more independent young women who whizzed around in the sunshine on motor scooters. Like the romantic travelers of the 19th century, I was hooked. I would make three more trips to Spain in the 1970s, even to an outsider with limited Spanish as mine was back then. It was clear that the country was in a ferment of change. Professional people in their 30s, part of a rapidly growing middle class, would give me lifts in their cramped Fiat 500s or boxy seat 124s. They were keen to talk to a foreigner about their frustration at the stasis of dictatorship and desperate to enjoy the same freedoms as their counterparts across Western Europe. They were often very kind. The only coldness I remember was on one occasion in Madrid. A young South African with whom I had shared a lift from Zaragoza took me to an uncle's flat on Calle Bravo Morillo on a stifling Saturday afternoon, as what was then a sleepy city of bureaucrats shutting down for the weekend. Perhaps understandably, the uncle, a civil servant and a Franquista, was not overjoyed to see us, but did let us stay the night in the flat with its dark, heavy furniture. Hitchhiking could be difficult. After waiting hours at the roadside, sometimes I gave up and took the train. The cheapest were called rápido or express. They stopped at almost every station and took many hours to get anywhere. With few motorways and no high-speed trains, Spain seemed like a much bigger country than it feels now. In 1972, Franco was almost a mummy. On his summer holiday in Galicia, the newspapers dutifully published photos of the elderly dictator fishing, his face hidden by dark glasses. In November 1975, he died in his bed. At last, a transition to democracy began. On regular visits to Spain over the next three decades, I saw a country swiftly transforming. It became an outwardly prosperous European nation, normal at last. Political scientists stopped lamenting Spanish exceptionalism, the notion that Spain is different, in the words of an official tourist slogan dreamed up under Manuel Fraga, Franco's information minister in the 1960s, a job title that revealed the nature of the regime. In 2008, just as a property bubble was bursting amid the financial crisis that shook the United States and Europe, I reported and wrote a 14-page special report on Spain for The Economist. I found a country on the verge of a deep slump about which it was mostly in denial. There were clear signs of the clash that would come in Catalonia. I titled the report, "The Party's Over." It touched a nerve in Spain. That edition of The Economist sold more than 20,000 extra copies on Spanish newsstands. In May 2016, I moved to Madrid, and I have lived there since. Today, Spain is a country where, superficially at least, progress has largely halted. The past dozen years have been hard ones, starting with the bursting of a property bubble and an economic slump between 2008 and 2012. Although a vigorous recovery followed, at times what Spaniards called convivencia, getting along together, has been strained. What seemed to be a robust democracy has suffered multiple jolts. Many of its institutions, from the monarchy to the courts and the political parties, have been called into question. The biggest shock came in Catalonia, where nationalism turned to separatism. In the autumn of 2017, Catalonia's devolved government, in the hands of separatists, organized an unconstitutional referendum and a unilateral declaration of independence. In response, the Spanish state placed a dozen separatist leaders on trial and jailed them in a move that seemed incomprehensible to many outsiders. And then came the COVID-19 pandemic, which hit Spain and its economy harder than many of its neighbors and exposed failures of governance, as it did everywhere. The Catalan events, in particular, prompted a revival of stereotypes, especially among commentators in Britain and the United States. In many portrayals, including their own, Catalan leaders were seen as representing an oppressed nation. Since Orwell, Catalonia has occupied a particular place in the romantic imagination, and many outsiders are all too ready to detect Franco's ghost at work in contemporary Spain. They, and some Spaniards, argue that the country is paying the price for what is held to have been a pact of forgetting during the transition to democracy. "The ghost of Franco still haunts Catalonia," opined Foreign Policy magazine in October 2017. "Ghosts of civil war haunt Spain in its Catalonia madness," echoed The Times in February 2019. In the aftermath of the Catalan autumn of 2017, Antonio Caño, then the editor of El País, the country's leading newspaper, complained to me, "There is always some Inglés who tells us that Spain is different. Spain is not different." In important ways, that is true. This book will argue that the country is not falling prey to atavistic authoritarianism, and that the ills of Spain over the past turbulent decade are not principally due to any original sin surrounding the birth of its democracy. They are, in many ways, those of other democracies around the world in the 2010s, in Europe, the United States, and Latin America. Hubris, austerity, populism, polarization, poor leadership, and the struggle to adapt to a rapidly changing world of globalization and technological change. Partly in response to austerity, but also to political strains, Spain has suffered three successive versions of populism. Two are new parties, Podemos on the hard left and Vox on the radical right, and the third is Catalan separatism, although it carries other meanings too. In many respects, the drive for Catalan independence can be bracketed with Brexit and Matteo Salvini's Liga in Italy, as among the most powerful populist nationalist revolutionary movements in Western Europe. But the Catalan clash can also be seen as just the latest iteration of Spain's centuries-old and still unresolved battle to reconcile its regional diversity with national unity. The issues revealed by Spain's recent travails are thus not just profound, but they are also of wider significance. What is a nation, and does it automatically require its own state? Should nations or regions in 21st century European democracies have the right to self-determination? Can referendums ever resolve divisive questions? Spain exemplifies other contemporary issues too. How can and should countries deal with a traumatic and divisive past? Is historical memory a democratic duty or a partisan political project? Why does Spain have such persistently high unemployment, and how can it overcome the legacy of two deep slumps? Does rapid social change necessarily prompt a conservative backlash? How can democratic politicians work together to provide coherent and reformist government in a fragmented and polarized political system? And can parliamentary monarchies survive misconduct by monarchs? The remainder of this book will address these questions. In doing so, it will sometimes look back, especially in chapters 3, 4, and 5. History doesn't determine, but it does influence how people think about the present. The book will also, at times, look sideways to assess how Spain is similar to other Western European democracies and in what ways history, geography, customs, and ideas have made it different. That these questions have arisen with such force is all the more poignant because in the quarter century or so after 1975, Spain had been such a success story. Despite everything, it remains so in many ways, as this book will also endeavor to demonstrate. In 2017, I went back to Fernán Núñez. The houses were of two or three stories, with some blocks of flats. The streets were lined with cars. There was a certain bustle about the place. The shops included a Chinese supermarket. Señora Juana, a 78-year-old who was sitting outside her home in the autumn sunshine, said that much had changed. "More people have land, and many have studied," she said. "Some commute to Córdoba, 30 kilometers away, but now quickly reachable by the motorway that has replaced the old road. She has three children. The eldest, a daughter, studied tourism and works in Mallorca. The second is a local policeman, and the youngest works as a plasterer. There are few better places in which to live than Spain. Yet if the country cannot find a path of political renewal, the permanence of its achievements will be in doubt." Chapter 1. The Unraveling. In the summer of 2008, Sir John J.H. Eliot, a British historian who was one of the foremost authorities on Spain's imperial apogee in the 16th and 17th centuries, presented a sharp-eyed paper at Menéndez Pelayo University in Santander, in which he forecast that the period between 1975 and 2000 may come to be seen in retrospect as a second golden age of Spanish history. He went on to say that the years since 2000 have seen the falling of shadows over what for a quarter of a century had seemed an increasingly sunny landscape. The shadows, he mentioned, included polarization, the reemergence of dogmatism, and narrow-minded nationalism and localism. To them would soon be added economic slump. 10 years later, when Spain's political world marked the 40th anniversary of the Constitution and the transition to democracy after Franco, those shadows had all but obscured the sun. Since 2008, Spain has been buffeted by setbacks and changes that have unfolded with dizzying speed, leaving almost no institution untouched. The anniversary celebrations, which included a special session of Parliament in December 2018, were thus bittersweet, imbued in some quarters with wistful nostalgia. At the turn of the millennium, Spain's swift move from Franco's long dictatorship to parliamentary democracy, with little violence and through negotiated agreements, was still widely hailed as exemplary. Now, a significant minority of political opinion in Spain, both on the left and on the right, rejects the constitutional settlement, though for different reasons. Writing on the anniversary in El País, the newspaper of the left-of-center political establishment, Felipe González, the socialist prime minister from 1982 to 1996, and the country's elder statesmen, urged politicians to recover the spirit of dialogue and understanding that had marked the process known in Spain simply as the transition. Let's not open new trenches after we filled in those that caused so much suffering, he urged. Spain's post-1975 transition broke almost two centuries of relative decline, political instability, and episodes of fratricidal conflict, punctuated by periods of reform and revival. Between 1812 and 1975, Spain saw six different constitutions, seven successful military pronunciamientos, bloodless coups, four royal abdications, two dictatorships, and four civil wars. The last and worst of these, known to the world simply as the Spanish Civil War, was the conflict of 1936 through 1939, triggered when Francisco Franco and several fellow generals staged an initially unsuccessful military coup against a center-left Popular Front government representing an unstable parliamentary republic, and Hitler, Mussolini, and Stalin all intervened. As Western Europe enjoyed peaceful, prosperous democracy in the decades after the Second World War, while Spain suffered Franco's iron rule, outside observers worried about the country's seeming backward exceptionalism. So did many Spaniards. Two powerful ideas guided the transition, both widely shared across much of the political spectrum. The first was that it was imperative to avoid any repeat of the Civil War of 1936 through 1939, which cost some 300,000 to 350,000 lives out of a population of around 25 million, in addition to a further 20,000 or so executed in the repression that followed the conflict. The second imperative was that Spain should become a normal Western European country. The transition was the result of pacts between modernizing moderates and the Franco regime, who knew that social peace and integration into Europe required democracy, and an opposition rendered pragmatic by decades of exile, prison, or clandestinity. The process was pushed along from above by King Juan Carlos, whom Franco had designated as his successor as head of state, and from mid-1976 by the new monarch's chosen prime minister, Adolfo Suárez, a previously obscure Franquista functionary of shrewd political instincts. Pressure for freedom came from below, too, in the form of strikes and protests. Once Franco was dead, many prohibitions quietly fell away before they were formally lifted, like flakes of dead, clotted skin from a scab. Traveling in Spain in those years, I found a self-confident sense among many younger people that they would create their own freedoms. There was resistance, too. Suárez faced down pressure from the army when he legalized the Communist Party, long the main internal opposition to Franco, ahead of a general election in June 1977, the first democratic election since 1936. Ahead of the vote, I spent a week in the Basque country. I attended a big socialist rally in a cavernous sports hall in Bilbao in which González, a lawyer from Seville who was the party's young and attractive leader, stressed that socialism is freedom against a backdrop of the party's new social democratic symbol, a hand clutching a red rose. More atmospheric was a meeting with local socialist candidates in a tightly packed fishermen's hall on the coast of Vizcaya. After decades in the shadows, left-wing politics had emerged into the open, in all its sectarian effervescence. In the rustling industrial suburbs of Bilbao, along the banks of the river Nervión At rallies of Euskadiko Esquerra, activists waved the ikurriña, the red, green, and white Basque flag, only legalized months before. The party represented a minority within ETA, the Basque terrorist organization which embraced the new democracy. The majority current in ETA senselessly continued to bomb, murder, and kidnap for decades, a source of tragedy and tension. Suarez's newly formed Union of the Democratic Center, UCD, won a majority in the 1977 election, with the socialists coming a strong second. To general surprise, Alianza Popular, AP, the conservative party, formed by Manuel Fraga and other former Franco ministers, fared poorly. Events then moved rapidly. In two intense and heady years, dictatorship was dismantled. The new Congress was tasked with drawing up a democratic constitution. The work was done by a committee of seven on which the communists, the AP, and the Catalan nationalists, as well as the two biggest parties, were all represented. All but one of Spain's previous constitutions had been dictated by the winning side in internal conflicts and rejected by the losers, and were thus rendered ephemeral. This time, the constitutionalists were determined to reach broad and durable agreements. Beyond its assertion of civil and political freedoms and socioeconomic rights within a market economy, the new charter involved two historic compromises. The left accepted a parliamentary monarchy instead of the republic it had fought to defend in the Civil War, whereas the right accepted devolution in place of Franco's unitary, centralized regime. This second compromise was expressed in Article 2 of the Constitution, which affirmed the indissoluble unity of the Spanish nation, while going on to recognize and guarantee the right to autonomy of the nationalities and regions that comprise it. This awkward formulation was an attempt to satisfy the claim of Basques, Catalans, and Gallegos to be nations without alienating conservatives. On paper, there were two other, clearer approaches that might have been adopted. One was federalism, favored by both socialists and communists, and the most logical solution to the Spanish conundrum of reconciling diversity and unity. But a chaotic and short-lived federal republic in 1873 had given the term an enduringly bad name, especially on the right. The other approach would have been to grant home rule solely to Catalonia, the Basque country, and Galicia, giving due recognition to their sense of difference, of being cultural nations and not just Spanish regions. But the political leaders were not wholly in control of events during the transition, and there was a widespread sense among Spaniards that democracy should involve the devolution of power. Even before the Constitution was drawn up, Suarez had agreed to the provisional restoration of home rule in Catalonia through an accord with Josep Tarradellas, the president of the Catalan government in exile. In October 1977, Tarradellas made a triumphal return to Barcelona after 38 years in France, when he proclaimed to the welcoming crowd, "Je suis aquí." Now I am here. It was far more than a statement of the obvious. A preliminary agreement for Basque home rule followed. Tarradellas recognized the unity of Spain and accepted the right to autonomy, home rule, of other Spanish regions. In December 1977, amid a generalization of regional sentiment, demonstrations for autonomy in Andalusia mobilized up to 1.5 million people. Other places, such as the Canary Islands, which had never before seen nationalist political movements, made similar demands. Even as the Constitutional Committee of the Cortes, Parliament, was deliberating, Suarez's government decreed pre-autonomous entities in a dozen regions. That was ill-advised. It prejudged the constitutional debate and made restricting autonomy to the historic three unviable. In the end, the Constitution's Title VIII on the territorial organization of the state was muddled and contradictory. It guaranteed the right to autonomy of nationalities and regions in that awkward fudge, but without defining or naming them. It attempted to establish two different classes of territorial unit, those whose autonomy derived from a statute approved by referendum, Article 151, and those where the Cortes approved autonomy, Article 144. The former were supposed to enjoy more powers more quickly. In the end, that distinction was abandoned. In a solution known as Café para Todos, Coffee for All, Spain was divided into 17 autonomous communities, plus the enclave cities of Ceuta and Melilla on the Moroccan coast. Each was to have its own elected parliament and government. The Estado Autonómico, autonomous state, as it was called, was in some ways a deft compromise, a kind of federalism that dare not speak its name. It worked well at first, and in many ways it has changed Spain for the good. The regions run education, health and social services, and much cultural policy and economic regulation. Catalonia and the Basque country have their own police forces and run their prisons. By 2017, the regions were responsible for 38% of total public spending, and local governments a further 15%. Yet, Title VIII stored up problems which have exploded in the past decade. Decentralization was open-ended. It was asymmetric, but in the course of time, it would prove to be not sufficiently so to satisfy Catalan and Basque nationalists who wanted more than just administrative decentralization. The framers of the Constitution tried hard to avoid the flaws that had contributed to the demise of the 1931 Republic and the lurch to civil war. They wanted to create strong, stable governments. The electoral system is based on proportional representation, but by awarding a minimum of 3 seats to each of the 50 provinces, it gave a bonus to the majority party as well as over-representing rural areas. Governments can only be overthrown by censure if their opponents secure a majority for an alternative candidate for prime minister. And the Constitution is hard to reform. To change its core provisions requires approval by a 3/5 majority in both chambers of parliament, then an election, then reiterated approval by 3/5 in the new parliament, and finally a referendum. This rigidity, too, would over time create new problems. In December 1978, the Constitution was approved in a referendum. It was the third national vote in 2 years, but 67% of the electorate turned out, of whom 87% voted yes. That figure was higher in Catalonia. Only in the Basque country did the new charter receive the support of less than a majority of the electorate. Only 45% turned out there, of whom 69% voted in favor. The Basque Nationalist Party had objected that the Constitution talked of updating their region's fueros, legal privileges, which they saw as primordial rights. The transition had 2 further pillars. While the constitutional deliberations were underway, a parallel negotiation quickly produced a socio-economic agreement called the Moncloa Pacts after the prime ministerial offices. In return for the recognition of trade union rights and a commitment to expand social spending, the left agreed to a mixed economy and wage restraint. Spain, which imports nearly all its oil, had been badly hit by the steep rise in oil price in 1973. The other pillar was a sweeping amnesty law approved in October 1977. This covered all acts of a political purpose, whatever their outcomes may have been, committed up to the election of June that year. It thus included ETA prisoners who had been convicted of murder, who were released. It also guaranteed that those who worked for the Franco regime would not be investigated or prosecuted for the crimes and misdemeanors that may have been committed by state authorities against the rights of others. This prevented any purge of the armed forces, the police, or the judiciary. Over time, the amnesty would become the single most controversial feature of the transition. It would be dubbed the Pact of Forgetting. That is a misnomer. Spanish society has remembered the Civil War and Franquista repression copiously in the years since, with an outpouring of books, films, and commemorations. What the amnesty did was to prevent the application of transitional justice and the punishment of Franquista officials. But amnesty had been a demand of the Communist Party and the left since 1956, and nobody in Spain, or indeed the world, was talking about transitional justice in 1977. That there was no purge also reflected the balance of forces in the late 1970s. Under the aegis of the Constitution and the Transition Settlement, Spain seemed to have slain its historical demons and assuaged chronic sources of unrest. Late but massive urbanization from 1950 onwards took the sting out of agrarian conflicts. The economy had begun decades of rapid growth in the late 1950s when Franco junked the autarky of the Falange, Spain's version of Mussolini's fascist party, and handed economic management to Catholic technocrats from Opus Dei. The socialists, led by González, won a landslide victory in 1982 and governed for the next 14 years. They updated the economy, shutting down antiquated state-run smokestack industries. They strengthened Franco's rudimentary welfare state, providing free healthcare and education for all, and reducing poverty. The Catholic Church, overmighty for centuries, faded as younger generations stayed away from Mass. After a failed coup attempt in 1981, fronted by a preposterous lieutenant colonel of the Civil Guard, the army came to terms with democracy. Spain's entry into the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO, in 1981, endorsed by a subsequent referendum organized by González, was an important step in the process by which the armed forces came to accept that their role is to protect against external rather than internal threats. Spain's entry to the European Economic Community, EEC, in 1986, along with Portugal, set the seal on its convergence with democratic Western Europe. Europe quickly became a pillar of the new Spain's identity. The country had also swiftly moved from Franco's gerontocracy to a young leadership. When Franco died, King Juan Carlos was 37, Suarez 43, and González just 33. The country swiftly shook off the dead hand of Franquista press censorship, as well as the hypocritical, patriarchal moralism of the church. Democracy ushered in a creative cultural frenzy in which Spaniards embraced sexual openness, drugs, and unbridled individual freedoms. Though Barcelona had long been Spain's cultural vanguard, in the 1980s, Madrid's La Movida, portrayed in the early films of Pedro Almodóvar, led the new counterculture. By 1996, after four terms in office, the socialists were politically tired, their record marred by reported episodes of corruption and abuses in the long struggle against ETA terrorism. The conservative opposition had regrouped as the Popular Party, PP, which brought together AP and many from the defunct UCD. It had a new young leader, José María Aznar, a former tax inspector who had briefly been the regional president of Castile and León. He had narrowly escaped an ETA assassination attempt in 1995. He moved the PP away from its Franquista origins towards something more akin to Christian democracy, a move rewarded with electoral victory in 1996. Peaceful alternation in office is the hallmark of a consolidated democracy, and so the transition was complete. In his two terms, Aznar concentrated on economic reforms, including privatizations. He was determined that Spain should qualify to join the Eurozone, as it did. While González had been an important player in Europe, Aznar was an Atlanticist who thought the way to expand Spain's international influence was to seek closer ties with the United States. Whether or not he was right, he failed to persuade Spaniards of that. Spain joined the U.S.-led coalition in the invasion of Iraq in 2003, although it did not deploy combat troops. Polls showed that 90% of respondents opposed the invasion. His personal unpopularity may have prompted Aznar to say he would not seek a third term, a meritorious decision in a country where leaders tend to cling on indefinitely. Even so, Aznar's chosen successor as leader of the PP, Mariano Rajoy, seemed poised to win the election in 2004. But on the morning of 11 March, 3 days before the vote, 10 bombs exploded simultaneously on several Madrid commuter trains, killing 191 people and injuring more than 2,000 in the country's worst-ever terrorist attack. Aznar tried to pin the blame on ETA. Officials pressed the media to do so, too. When it quickly became clear that the perpetrators were Islamist extremists, many Spaniards were outraged at this deceit and confirmed in their view that the Iraq venture had made the country vulnerable. A huge turnout of voters gave the socialists, under a new and inexperienced leader, José Luis Rodríguez Zapatero, a narrow and wholly unexpected victory. This episode injected lasting poison into the political system, with both the main parties accusing the other of playing dirty. Zapatero, when their first patronymic surname is a common one, such as Rodríguez, Spaniards tend to be known by their second, maternal one, represented a new generation whose political lives had not been shaped by dictatorship. Although he had studied law, his only profession was politics. He had entered parliament aged 26 and unexpectedly won the socialist leadership in a primary by campaigning against the party's old guard. With striking green eyes and a tactile manner, he was certainly a political animal. He was dismissed by some as a lightweight. Because of that and his physical appearance, he was cruelly dubbed Bambi by Alfonso Guerra, González's deputy. Zapatero was more cunning and ruthless than that description allowed, but he would prove to be a disappointment. In hindsight, he seemed in many ways as if he wanted to be the first prime minister from Podemos, a hard-left party which did not exist until 2014, rather than a moderate social democrat in the mold of González. His decision to withdraw the 1,300 Spanish peacekeeping troops that Aznar had sent to Iraq after the U.S. invasion was popular at home and honored a campaign commitment. But the manner in which he carried it out, abruptly and with no consultation, soured Spain's relationship with Washington for years to come. It also suggested a deep streak of anti-Americanism in Zapatero that would become more pronounced after he left office. In Aznar's second term, when the PP had an absolute majority in Congress, and then under Zapatero, the consensual approach that underlay the transition began to break down. It had already weakened in González's last term. It was replaced by what Spaniards called crispación, meaning tension. To some extent, this was simply politics as usual, and a sign of the growing self-confidence of Spanish democracy. But it had a destructive side. Commentators began to compare the national political debate to a painting by Goya in the Prado, in which two men face off against each other, swinging heavy clubs, even as both sink into a quicksand. Zapatero began a culture war, seeking wedge issues with which to provoke the PP. Some of his reforms represented welcome modernization of social norms. They included same-sex marriage, a law against domestic violence, and the promise of public money for the care of elderly or disabled people. These measures strengthened the idea of citizenship and made for a more creative, more tolerant society Zapatero told me when I sat down with him for an hour at the Moncloa Palace, the prime ministerial offices, in September 2008. Most Spaniards agreed with him, but the measures provoked the conservative bishops who headed the Catholic Church into organizing protests against the government. Rajoy, smarting from his election defeats, was happy to support them. Zapatero thus maneuvered the PP into portraying itself as more reactionary than the average Spaniard, and perhaps more than it really was. Two other initiatives were even more controversial. One was a new Catalan statute of autonomy. The other was a law of historical memory. This offered government money and help for the relatives of victims of the Franco regime, often dumped in unmarked graves, to find and rebury their dead. That righted a clear wrong. The law also called for all plaques on public buildings or street names commemorating the old regime to be removed. More generally, the law left many, and not just on the right, queasy, in that the government appeared to be upholding a particular view of the Civil War rather than leaving the matter to Spanish society. The opposition also attacked Zapatero for holding talks with ETA, which were inconclusive, though both Aznar and González had done the same. Spain's economy had continued to grow strongly, unemployment had fallen steadily, and living standards had converged towards the European average. This was the culmination of an extraordinarily successful four decades, from 1960 to 2000, in which Spain became one of only a dozen countries in the world to make the leap from middle income to high income, developed status. Joining the EEC helped, but the cornerstones for growth had been laid during the later period of Franco's rule, in which policymaking became technocratic, the economy became increasingly open and market-oriented, and private investment boomed. In 1986, Spain's income per person was only 68% of the EEC average. By 2007, that figure had risen to 90% of the average of the European Union's, EU's, then 15 members. Spanish business became increasingly self-confident and global. By 2008, the list of the world's 500 biggest firms by market value, compiled by the Financial Times, included 14 from Spain, up from 8 in 2000. Entry into the euro in 1999 meant that Spain suddenly enjoyed Germany's low interest rates, but without German competitiveness. Cheap money fueled a housing boom. On the outskirts of every Spanish city and town, and even some villages, arose neat rows of houses or blocks of flats. When the first signs of the credit crunch hit the American and European economies in 2007, Spain was building 700,000 new housing units a year, more than France, Germany, and Italy combined. Only a small proportion of those homes were required to meet the increased demand generated by a wave of immigration that saw Spain's population jump from 40 million to 45 million between 2000 and 2008. Many of the new arrivals found jobs on building sites. The government subsidized home ownership. As Spaniards got richer, they poured their savings into housing. Jesus Encinar, an entrepreneur who founded Idealista.com, an online estate agency, told me in 2008 that Spain had about 50% more homes than households. Many middle-class families acquired second homes near the beach or in their grandparents' village, or as an investment. There was no tax on empty property. There was another factor driving the housing boom: the powerful and allegedly sometimes corrupt nexus between local politicians, property developers, and the cajas de ahorros, savings banks, that in 2008 accounted for half of the country's financial system. Spanish towns are typically quite dense, ending abruptly in open countryside. Building on vacant land required the ayuntamiento, the municipal government, to extend the town limits by rezoning rural land for development. The ayuntamiento was entitled to 10% of the development land. Selling this 10% back to the developer became a main source of revenue for many municipalities. Sometimes, councilors took bribes to approve new developments. The third side of this triangle was the cajas. Their original remit was to act as non-profit savings and loans outfits and devote the proceeds to local good causes. But deregulation allowed them to operate behind their home patch, and they were colonized by local politicians. The cajas, too, stumped up much of the money for the herd of white elephants that trampled Spain's landscape and finances during the last years of the economic boom, the product of the puffed-up ambitions of regional and municipal politicians and the voracity of construction bosses. There were airports with no flights, as at Ciudad Real and Castellón. There were motorways with few cars, as around Madrid, at a cost of billions to the taxpayer, or, more modestly, a 120 million euro tramway in Jaén that has never operated. There were cultural centers with little culture, such as a Museum of Iberian Culture in Jaén, again, which remained almost empty a decade after it opened, or the City of Culture in Santiago de Compostela, an assemblage on a hillside overlooking the town which resembles a ski jump designed by a drunk. And then there were the hundreds of thousands of flats with no inhabitants, many on the wrong side of the motorways from the beach. The construction sector came to account for 12% of Spain's GDP, gross domestic product, when in any other developed country, 5% is normal. Regulators failed to step in. It appeared that mid-level officials at the Bank of Spain, the central bank, charged with monitoring the financial system, were too close to the banks. The bank had warned that house prices were overvalued back in 2003, but that prompted an outcry and it became more timid. It had also insisted on counter-cyclical provisioning by the banks, but only to a modest extent. To a degree, the whole country was complicit in the bubble. "It was a national mistake," said Pablo Hernández de Cos, the governor of the Bank of Spain since 2018. What we didn't know was that the bursting of the property bubble would coincide with an international financial crisis. The party came to a sudden halt in 2007 when the European Central Bank raised its interest rate. The economy sank into recession and credit flows dried up. Spain was caught naked. A current account deficit of 10% of GDP could no longer be financed, and Spanish banks found no takers in financial markets for their bundles of mortgage loans. In September 2008, when I interviewed scores of Spanish politicians, officials, and business leaders for an Economist special report, I found a few, including Pedro Solbes, the long-serving finance minister, who were aware of the gravity of the situation. Plenty of others, starting with Zapatero, were in denial. We spoke days after Lehman Brothers, an American investment bank, had gone out of business, triggering financial market chaos. "Once calm returns to the international system, we will return to growth without the Spanish economy having suffered structural damage," Zapatero told me. He mistook what was a structural problem for a cyclical one and tried to fight the slump with demand-priming measures, such as a pension increase and a short-lived grant of 2,500 euros for the parents of newborn babies. A decade later, in a world of low interest rates, greater tolerance for fiscal deficits, and greater aversion to austerity, he might have got away with it. But those were not the conditions in the Eurozone during the great financial crisis. Zapatero's Spain was in part a victim of the European authorities' zeal to defend their still-fledgling currency with austerity. Spain entered recession in a strong fiscal position, with a surplus in 2007 and a public debt at a low 36% of GDP, compared with Italy's 44% in that year or 44% in the United Kingdom. But as the recession undermined tax revenues, the deficit soared. It peaked at 11% of GDP in 2009. The European Commission and Angela Merkel, the German Chancellor, pressed Zapatero into a humiliating retreat. With the support of the PP, in 2011, the Cortes approved an amendment to the Constitution mandating budget balance over the medium term and giving legal priority to debt payments over other public spending commitments. Zapatero's government also pushed through modest reforms of the labor market and pensions. A few months later, Rajoy and the PP won an absolute majority in a general election, having begun his career as a property registrar in Pontevedra in Galicia. Rajoy had steadily worked his way up the PP hierarchy. His flaws were obvious. In public, he seemed a plodding and cautious bureaucrat. Nobody could accuse him of having anything as daring as a vision. He had the caginess of a typical gallego, Galician, of whom it is jokingly said that if you meet them on the stairs, you never know if they are going up or going down, rather like the chamberlain in Las Meninas. His qualities, and he had them, were less evident. In private, he could be affable, witty, and razor sharp. He was quietly ruthless, clinging on to his job as leader of the PP, despite two election defeats and seeing off an attempt by Aznar to unseat him at a party conference in 2008. He was dogged and determined, not easily thrown off course. If Aznar had displayed touches of both libertarianism and Thatcherism, Rajoy was a genuine conservative in the mold of Edmund Burke, a moderate rather than an ideologue who thought change a regrettable inevitability, to be managed as best one could. Rajoy took office in the depth of slump. The continuing problems of Spanish banks weighed upon the country's sovereign credit rating. Spain was widely expected to be forced to seek a full-scale bailout from the European Commission, and with it, the policing of the men in black, as international financial officials came to be dubbed. Unemployment peaked at 27% in 2013, when 6.3 million Spaniards were out of work. Then, a robust recovery began. This was partly due to favorable circumstance, such as the fall in international interest rates, the determination of Mario Draghi, the president of the European Central Bank, to do whatever it takes to save the euro, and generally low oil prices. But the revival also owed much to Rajoy's reforms. Three measures were particularly important. First, the government at last cleaned up the financial system, helped by the promise of a 100 billion euro loan from the EU, of which only 40 billion euros was used. It merged or shut down scores of the broken cajas. It nationalized four insolvent banks, including Bankia, a big one. Bankia was the result of a forced merger in 2010. Its main constituents were Caja Madrid and Bancaja Valencia. In 2011, it listed its shares on the Madrid Stock Exchange. Its managers punted the shares to its customers as a safe investment. Within months, Bankia had to be nationalized again. Its shares were worthless, wiping out the savings of tens of thousands of people. Bankia's chairman, Rodrigo Rato, Aznar's finance minister, who then went on to head the International Monetary Fund, IMF, was eventually convicted, along with many other senior managers, for embezzlement for having issued themselves with undeclared credit cards, which they used for private purchases they never repaid. Again, the Bank of Spain had failed in what was its main function after the creation of the euro, to ensure the stability of the financial system. One of my main missions, admitted Hernández de Cos, is to restore the reputation of the bank. He was more outspoken than his predecessors in warning of risks facing the economy. Second, after a slow start, Rajoy began to get the public finances under control, rejecting calls to accept a Greek-style general bailout of the economy. He was vindicated when this proved unnecessary. He thus was able to cut the deficit gradually, keeping political control over the process. He had irritated European Commission officials when he unilaterally but realistically raised Spain's deficit target for 2012 from 4% of GDP to 5.8%. The government paid off the arrears that regional administrations had run up with their suppliers, which added up to 5% of GDP. That saved many small businesses, according to a minister. Rajoy also held the nominal value of pensions steady. Since Spain saw several years of price falls, that meant they increased slightly in real terms, and extended the period for which unemployment benefit was paid. Third, the government pushed through changes to the rigid labor laws. After years in which Spanish labor costs had risen faster than the European average, the reform allowed for the devolution of wage bargaining to firm level, although rarely invoked. This forced restraint on the unions. For fair dismissals, redundancy pay was cut from 45 days per year worked to a still generous 33 days, making layoffs more bearable for companies. The unions hated the reform, but it meant that when the economy started growing again, jobs were created much more swiftly than in the past. Spain has passed from being a country on the brink of bankruptcy to a model of recovery that provides an example to the European Union, Rajoy proclaimed in 2015. He was right, but many Spaniards, still suffering the effects of the slump, did not see it that way, as well as the notorious case of Bankia. The crash exposed other examples of malfeasance. Unlike Italy, Spain is not systemically corrupt, but an unfortunate byproduct of regional autonomy was to create one-party fiefs in which politicians came to enjoy a sense of impunity and entitlement, and in some places, corruption flourished at a local level. In November 2012, in the depth of the recession, I made a reporting trip to Barcelona and Madrid.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.